Hello, welcome to a new edition of our show, Money is Business. And as we always say, business means money, stability, and business. And a lot more mean a lot of money. Well, what's going on right now? This is what we're going to find out, especially that we stepped into a new age, especially Egypt, a new age, a new republic, with a new founder, the first modern the foundation of the Egyptian Republic was during Muhammad Ali the Great, and he founded the modern Egypt that we knew. Now, you know, we do have another modern Egypt according to the age and a new republic. What happened? A lot of work has been happening. And let me just say something before we go for a short break. After she'll be coming back, talking to our guest and having the wrap-up of what happened during the week. Ministry of Finance Mohamed Mouaid said on Saturday that the government has been on maintaining stability of tax policies amid the economic reforms aimed at achieving fiscal consolidation, referring to unprecedented reforms to the tax laws. Mouaid said that upgrading and digitizing the tax systems could spur investments and attract investors after easing the measures of the taxpayers, and this is something very crucial, actually. The minister added that the tax revenues were expected to increase by 15% in the past fiscal year without getting people to bear more burdens. And we'll talk about a lot of more achievements, but after the short break, and we'll be coming back. Dr. Tariq Sulaiman, head of the livestock and poultry wealth development sector at the Ministry of Agriculture, said that the poultry industry has witnessed a remarkable development through many financing and encouragement opportunities provided by the state, explaining that the Ministry of Agriculture has increased investment opportunities for small and large breeders, which pushed the sector forward. He explained that Egypt is on the cusp of reaching self-sufficiency in poultry production after Egypt reached 98% of poultry. And as for table eggs, Egypt has reached self-sufficiency and exports more than our needs. Dr. Khalil Anani, Minister of Tourism and Antiquities, revealed a number of tourism statistics related to the numbers and rates of incoming tourism movement to Egypt during the years 2019, 2020, and 2021. He pointed out that the year 2019 was the highest year in tourism numbers that Egypt witnessed and the highest in tourism income, as the number of tourists reached about 13 million tourists and tourism income was $13 billion. The ministry explained that the past 2020 has started a strong start that heralds the continuation of achieving the targeted tourism growth, as the average number of tourists in January and February 2020 amounted to 945,000 tourists and expected return was estimated at $16 billion by the end of 2020. He explained that the average number of tourists that Egypt received from March 2021 until June of the same year reached more than 500,000 tourists per month, or more than 45% of the same period in 2019, pointing out that these rates are good compared to the surrounding tourist destinations. In a process considered the largest in Sudan's history, the executive boards of the World Bank and the International Monetary Fund decided that Sudan had taken the necessary steps to provide debt relief through the Enhanced Heavily Indebted Poor Countries HIPC initiative. The HIPC initiative, an agreement between major international lenders, provides a new opportunity for countries struggling to find a way out through which they can reduce the burden of debt. Sudan was able to liquidate 90% of its external debts after obtaining a debt forgiveness amounting to $50 billion, and this represents the largest exemption process in the history of the initiative. A senior banking official commented on the issue of Syrian deposits in Lebanese banks, where they indicated that the share of Syrians resident and non-resident and those without Lebanese nationality, which was approved in the accounts opening contracts between $6 and $7 billion. On the other hand, the Lebanese banks have been very strict for years in accepting the opening of accounts for Syrians due to the international sovereign sanctions on Syria. So President Assad had indicated in the speech that the biggest obstacle to investment in Syria is the Syrians' money frozen in the Lebanese banks. Iran has started operating a crude oil export terminal from the Jaz port on the Sea of Oman, allowing tankers to avoid crossing the strategic Strait of Hormuz, which has repeatedly been the scene of tension with the United States in a war described by President Hassan Rouhani as historic. The station is connected to a pipeline with a length of about 1,000 kilometers, allowing tankers to shorter days of their journey and bypass the Gulf waters and the strait through which about a fifth of global oil exports pass, especially those of Saudi Arabia, the regional rival of the Islamic Republic. The United States and Germany have reached an agreement on the controversial Nord Stream 2 pipeline, which includes sanctions against Russia and seeks to extend gas transit through Ukraine. The project, which passes through the Baltic Sea, has met strong opposition from Ukraine, which has been fighting pro-Moscow separatists since 2014 and considers the transport of Russian gas through its territory a vital means of pressure. It is worth mentioning that Nord Stream is a pipeline to transport natural gas from the city of Vyborg in Russia to the city of Greifswald in Germany. The line actually consists of two parallel lines. The first was put into service in November 2011. The second was put into service in October 2012. With a length of 1,222 kilometers, it is the longest undersea pipeline in the world. All right, back again to Money Means Business, what's new in the New Republic, Egypt, but the New Republic with the new achievements and the new everything that is taking place. Well, we have with us Dr. Saeed Al-Khoury, Professor of Management at Shams University. Welcome with us, sir, here.
Thank you.
It's always a pleasure having you.
Same to you.
Well, you know, I just read a small piece of information or news about Minister of Finance Mohamed Ait when he talked about digitizing the tax system that could spur, said that could spur investments and attract investors after easing the measures for the taxpayers. And this is, you know, could be attracting and encouraging the investments in Egypt here. He also said that the tax revenues were expected to increase by 15% by the past fiscal year without getting people to bear more burdens, which is good because, you know, people always worry about that.
Absolutely. In order to attract foreign direct investment in Egypt, beside reinventing the law of investment in Egypt, which we have done a few years ago, of course, we have to give the investor, I'm talking about foreign direct investment, incentive, tax incentive, in order to come and invest in Egypt. Of course, when you give tax incentive to the investor, increase the amount of money and project in Egypt, it would really decrease the unemployment rate, and it opens the economy more widely in order to get more and more. So the more business get into Egypt, the more investment goes to Egypt. It doesn't have a burden for me and you as a taxpayer. And of course, this would increase the budget of Egypt because our budget depends on three sources. One of them, it is the tax revenue and customs and so on. And another one from agriculture, industry and so on. And the third part from the transfer of money from our Egyptian people working abroad and the invest in Egypt. So that's the three sources. And one major source of the budget is from tax revenue. In order to give incentive for the investor to come to Egypt, that is a good news. It will increase the size of project in Egypt and industry. And remember, President Sisi last year opened the door for the fourth industrial revolution. And fourth industrial revolution, it comes from outside in order to have a new technology, a new investment, and this will really reduce the unemployment rate to the minimum. And of course, increase the physical budget for Egypt from increasing the tax budget also. And well, that is a good news.
This is a good thing. You know, like, let me just talk about management. Whenever we talked beforehand, years past, when things just hit rock bottom and with all the havoc that happened, you know, everybody was talking about management. You always hear the word management. We need good management. We need good management of crisis. You know, all that. Suddenly, all that, the word disappeared, because it was like, we should be doing this, we should be doing that, but then nobody's talking about it anymore, because it's being, well, nobody says the management, because the management is there.
Of course, I believe I can summarize this in one word.
Yeah.
It's the leadership. Whatever it happened in the last 6-7 years in Egypt, it doesn't come by accident.
Definitely.
The first of all, they developed Egypt Vision 2030, and that is a strategy. And when you talk about strategy, you're talking about vision. And the leadership of Egypt has a vision. Vision in terms of infrastructure, yeah, which we see it in reality now. Every Egyptian can really see it in terms of road, tunnels, and bridges. We see it now in agriculture, where the size of land developed in Egypt, it's a huge, a million and a half acres. It's a new thing for Egypt. And also investing in industry,
yeah,
and in investing in tourism, investing in all different perspective. Of course, that is Egypt Vision 2030. So when we talk about management is, it simply means a strategy. Management, it means, I call it as a magic sticks for success, is management. So years ago, we didn't really take in our consideration very seriously the world of management. We do it trial and error. And you can see it the last 30, 40 years, we try things and it doesn't work, we go over another thing. And now we have a strategy, and we go with the strategy step in, by step, in terms of education, in terms of health care. Remember, all the world suffer from COVID-19, except really Egypt, because we have a strategy, we have a health care security for Egyptian. And in terms of education, we didn't really stop education. We went through it, and we graduated people from most of the country. They really stopped educational system for a long period of time. It didn't happen in Egypt. And when we talk about management, we talk about strategy, we talk about Egypt Vision 2030, and also, above all of that, it is the leadership of President Sisi.
Definitely. Since you brought up education, now there were the exams of Sana'a Amma. Some people complain about some exams. And, well, you know, you do always hear the bad things, you don't hear the good things about, you know, people complaining all the time. But then they were complaining about, online education. They were complaining about that. But then with time, you know, and the situations that happen, it proves that the system is right of preempting all these problems that take place. How are things going in education? How do you see the system going, whether in, you know, Sana'a Amma or generally, and universities?
I believe when we talk about strategy in terms of education, we must have awareness.
Yeah.
Awareness means you have to define for the people who are using the system what the system is all about. So before you implement, you should really make full awareness for the people and preparation. I believe in, when it comes to education, I'm talking about pre-college education, like high school and all of that, you must go gradually. Gradually means you don't implement the full system for all people at one short period of time. Mm-hmm. You have to give them the chance to get used to the system. And the system, it's integration between the instructor and the student, and the infrastructure of the schooling system. Implementing online, it needs a platform, and you have to develop that first and then implement. Mm-hmm. And all the complaints we faced in the last few days, and especially today with the exam and so on, the students, they are not really trained in order to use this system, I believe the system is absolutely good and beautiful, and it's a magnificent system. But it really goes behind a certain basic idea, which we call it as a critical thinking.
Yeah.
Critical thinking, you don't have it in high school or in college education, but you have to train a student from KGE for critical thinking. And this, it takes time. And so before implementation, you must have awareness. You have to share knowledge between the people who implement the system and the people who are receiving the system, like parents, like students, and so on. And I believe this, it will go through, it will go by the time we implement the system, it will really revive and it will be better in the next year and so on. But right now, what I see it is people are not used to the system. And
the change,
absolutely.
Yeah.
And of course, when you have a change, you have a resistance to change.
Definitely.
But I believe the core idea from the system is critical thinking. Mm-hmm. And critical thinking, you have to really train people and practice from early years of education, not in the last year of education. Because remember, the high school diploma, it is a national security and it's a national thing, mm-hmm. where they have millions of students go through this unified exam, and you are going to hear a lot in the next days and so on. If they have a problem with certain exam, they blow up the whole system. Mm-hmm. But I believe we should really take good care of the system. The system is excellent, but you have to implement it gradually, and you have to build the infrastructure in order to use the online educational system. Of course, the system, it's built on what we call true, false, and multiple choice questions.
Yeah, and that was an easy thing when we were at school. I just don't know. It's tricky. Some questions are tricky, and it's not really very applicable when, you know, like Egyptian schools, I think, or the Egyptian system.
The Egyptian system, we all educational system in Egypt, they are based on knowing knowledge by heart.
Yeah.
And the new system is you have to search for information.
Definitely.
Search the information through the Egyptian Knowledge Bank, search for information through the internet, through going to the library and so on. And that is the core system, which is an excellent, that's an American system, an Europe system.
Yeah.
They have the same and they are very successful. But in Egypt, we have it in knowing by heart, giving private tutoring and so on. And where parents pay a lot of money in order for their kids to get a higher grade. With the new system, it doesn't work like that.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to compromise between multiple choice, true, false questions, and
open book exams,
and written and essay, and so on.
Yeah. But do you think, you know, like as you mentioned, that, you know, like parents pay a lot for private tutoring and all that, but then if, well, with this, you know, like they have to be really examining everything. They have to be researching things in order to answer questions or do their research papers. So would that limit the problem of education, paying for tutors?
Absolutely. We talked about that years ago, where we have the educational system in Europe and in the States, for example.
Well, we'll talk more about that, but we'll go for a short break after.
Sure.
We should be coming back.
Sure.
Stay tuned to us. Don't go away.
Minister of International Cooperation Dr. Raniel Machat said that the Arab Republic of Egypt ranked fourth among 50 largest economies in the whole world in the new Return to Normalcy Index launched by the International Economist magazine. The minister explained that the new index covers 50 of the world's largest economies, which collectively represent 90% of the global GDP and 76% of the population, explaining that Egypt's coming in fourth place reflects the flexibility with which the state dealt with the corona pandemic and its ability to withstand in the face of the crisis through economic and social reforms while continuing its quest to implement its 2030 development vision and achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. The Economist Index on the Return to Normal Life consists of three groups, the first being the Transportation and Travel Group, the Entertainment Group, and the Retail and Work Group. Precautions due to COVID-19, according to The Economist, the Normality Index fell in April 2020 to its lowest level to a record 35 points due to the restrictions imposed by countries with the start of the spread of the coronavirus, but it gradually improved over the following months and is currently recording 67 points, which reflects that the world has come halfway to return to life. What it was like before the corona pandemic? It's worth noting that the Egyptian economy was praised by many international institutions, which indicated its ability to achieve positive economic growth during the past year. The World Bank and the European Bank for Reconstruction and Development hailed the positive growth of the Egyptian economy during the past year, despite the contraction of most of the world's economies, with expectations positive continued growth in the coming years to return to the pre-pandemic level, thanks to the major national projects that are being implemented and the economic reforms that took place in the period from 2016 to 2019.
And coming back again from our report, and we were talking about education, and one of the things of the most important, of course, you know, like building the human being, and private tutoring, well, what it became is not really helping because of the new system. It shouldn't be as it was. So, you know, the new system, would it encourage or discourage and limit the system of private education in Egypt?
Would eliminate it. It will eliminate it. You know, we don't have like a private tutoring.
Yeah.
It's an Egyptian thing, you know. And of course, the parents, all parents, they are willing their kids to get a higher grade to go for the top, like medical school, engineering school, and so on. So they pay a lot of money in terms of private tutoring in order for their kids to get a higher grade. And that is. It's an Egyptian thing, you know, which yeah. In order to change, it's a culture change. In order to change this culture, you have to do it gradually. Not right away. You know, it takes time.
But this is very tricky, you know. It's like everything is happening fast because we need, it's very important that we just achieve a lot of what we're lagging in the past period. So, you know, things are just going simultaneously in all directions and going, you know, of course, definitely like starting also with education, that's very important. And, you know, it's really very hard for the decision maker and for the ones that are doing the things that they're supposed to be doing. And it's a great upheaval in all systems, especially the system of education. Is it kind of, how do the students take it?
They are not taking in the right way.
Yeah.
Again, let me confirm that the system is perfect. The system is excellent.
But knowing the tricks, let's see.
But really, awareness is very important and it takes time. And you have to train a student for that, not during the exam, before the exam.
Yeah.
The awareness, it takes years in order to get a full population with a large number of students taking their exam in high school, for example. And this, it takes time. But the system is perfect. The system is working very well in all different countries. But here is the culture things. Egyptian, they are used to know things by heart. They don't have to come with their idea. The system, the idea behind the system, it let people think, let the student really think and create and be innovative in order to enhance the educational system for the future. And this it has to be translated to the parents, it has to be translated to the student, it has to be translated to the instructor who teach this method. And of course, with, for example, with IG, for example, as a practice system, the teacher, the instructor, they develop model for student and know by heart in order to get high grade in SAT and IG and so on. And that is not good, for example, to know things by heart versus to be creative and be innovative.
Yeah.
It's two different systems. Mm-hmm. And in order for the Egyptian student to get used to that, you have to develop a strategy for awareness for the kids, for the student, for parents, and for the instructor. And this takes time.
And how is the grading system, you know, if, you know, like there is that kind of, you know, not really sure, you know, how things are in this, you know, learning the system yet. So some things seem to be problematic for them, yet they're not used to it. So does the grading system take that into consideration?
No, the grading system is it's e-grading also, where you have a bubble sheet, where you put true or false or multiple choice, select one answer. And the computer, he doesn't care. You insert your card into the machine, and they give you the final grade. And no human people, no human
get involved,
interfere in this grading system. And it's fair grading system.
Mm-hmm.
But remember, I have a very important comment. I say it's very important to let our kids know how to write in terms of Arabic or in English or French. To write paragraphs and so on. The writing skills is very important for our kids for the future. I have a student doing a PhD with me and master, and they don't know how to write in Arabic. And that is, it's a big problem, of course.
Definitely.
So you have to have integrative system between true, false, multiple choice, and also essay question in order to really figure out how people think.
Are the essays now, you know, involved in the system? Writing essays,
very little.
We had to had to do that during college.
In the future, they try to eliminate it at all, which I don't think it's a good idea.
Yeah. Okay. Mm. It will happen later on. Well, it's important for the dissertations and all that, definitely.
The dissertation it's an essay by itself, you know, but I'm talking about the coursework and the grading system.
Yeah.
It goes in the coursework.
Okay, definitely. Mm. Well, you know, all that, you know, goes hand in hand with the other development taking place, and as we see, well, a tremendous upheaval. Like, if someone is going out of Egypt, or someone who hasn't been to Egypt for a couple of years, or, you know, it's going to be even more if he hasn't been here for 7 or 8 years, and he comes back to Egypt, what is he going to see? You know, is he going to recognize the Egypt that he left?
It happened to me last week. I have visitor from the Gulf.
Yeah.
And when I met them, they told me Egypt change in a daily basis, not in a year basis. In a daily basis, we see change.
Very fast.
And the people come from outside. They see a major change in Egypt, a major change in terms of the infrastructure in all different means. Of course, when they come from, for example, from Mohandesin or Zamalek and so on, to go to Heliopolis, it used to take an hour and a half or 2 hours. Now it's in 20 minutes.
Yeah.
And thanks for the infrastructure, for the roads, for the bridges they have right now. And they see it in action. Of course, the major highway, Alexandria Highway, Suez Highway, Ismailia Highway, Daba Highway, it is really a state-of-the-art highway. It's the same infrastructure as you can see it in Shanghai or in New York or in Europe and so on. That is a good news. We see a change not in a yearly basis or in a monthly basis. We see it in a daily basis. And remember, again, there is a leadership in Egypt where they follow day by day.
Definitely.
Day
everything.
By day. And Egypt, my belief in the next 2 years, Egypt, it will be in a different position worldwide.
Definitely. Also, finding out in developing areas that were ignored or not developed, the paradise, different paradise, places that were unknown to tourists or Egyptians who did not really care going there because they didn't really know about this. But right now, we have new venues, actually new cities, and other cities that are being developed in order to absorb the population increase. Plus, to also develop the countryside, develop Upper Egypt and places that were marginalized, and creating jobs in there for the categories that were marginalized, and poverty is there. Also with the initiative Haya Karima or Decent Life that helps in that, there is a lot that is happening throughout the whole republic.
Let me follow on that. I have 2 weeks ago, I have two university presidents from the States were visiting Egypt, and they were planning their trip for 1 week. And after they saw whatever is happening in Egypt, and I remember that is not a regular guy, it's American, and he is a president of a major university in the States, in New Jersey. And he told me, you need a month in order to see whatever is going on in Egypt. And he's planning to come in October, for example, to spend with his family a whole month in Egypt. Now Upper Egypt, they have a major development, and all the seaside in Egypt, whether
new in paradise everywhere,
North Coast, it is a magnificent development. Remember El Alamein and so on. It's a major change in Gharda, it's a major change in Sharm, there is a major change. And the Great Museum of Egypt, it's a great change also. And now we are, today, the Prime Minister announced a new project in Egypt, Mosque of Egypt, for example. And all of that, it is a vision. Yeah. So Egypt is moving toward a new position, and that is a new republic. A new republic, it doesn't concentrate only on industry, agriculture, tourism, education, healthcare, but also taking care of social security of the people.
Yeah.
And remember what you mentioned, Hayaga is a goodwill of Egyptian Haya Karima. It is a movement toward to help the needy people to have a new high quality of life for Egyptian people. And of course, we're providing them with health care, with housing, and they are furnishing their new houses and so on. And all this random area in Egypt, it is a major development in it right now. And as President Sisi promised, we'll be able within a year or two, will really all the random area, it will be demolished in Egypt, and we'll have a new, that is a new republic.
Definitely.
And taking care of social security is very important issue. Helping needy people, it is very important issue. Of course, me and you and all middle class, really we should stand beside the policy and the strategy of Egypt in order to put Egypt in a new direction.
Definitely, definitely. Well, we'll go for a short break with the report, after which we will be coming back talking more. Stay tuned to us. Don't go away.
Prime Minister Dr. Mustafa Medbouli witnessed the signing ceremony of a partnership contract between the Arab Organization for Industrialization and the German DMG Moore Company to establish a factory for the production of CNC-programmed automatic control machines in Egypt, in the presence of Minister of Trade and Industry Dr. Naveen Gana. The establishment of a factory for the production of automatic CNC machines, which is the first of its kind in Africa, comes within the framework of what was agreed upon during a meeting of President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi with company top officials. After the signing, Lieutenant General Abdelmanam Taras, head of the Arab Organization for Industrialization, explained that the past years have witnessed cooperation between the company and a number of parties in many areas, including the medical industries, the pump project, the development of the SEMAF factory to develop and modernize the railways. Lieutenant General Taras indicated that the partnership contract includes investing in the establishment of a fully automated and highly programmed factory for the production of turning and milling equipment on an area of about 60,000 square meters within the headquarters of the Arab Organization for Industrialization, and is the first smart factory of its kind in Egypt and the Black Continent, and is scheduled to be opened officially during the year 2023. For his part, Christian Tunis, chairperson of the executive board of the company, said, "In recent years, thanks to the efforts of President al-Sisi, the situation of the Egyptian economy has improved and the country has opened up to more new growth opportunities, and Egypt has become an economy with promising potential for investment." He pointed out that with this step, Egypt would become a center for industries in the African and Arab region, and the establishment of this factory aims to localize the technology of manufacturing CNC machines, in addition to training and qualifying human cadres and achieving a major qualitative leap for the Egyptian industry. It's scheduled to open new training site for the DMG Moray Academy in the new factory to contribute to German education in educating qualified young people working in Egypt, as well as offering training courses on a large scale in Egyptian schools and universities, in addition to contributing to the modernization of industrial education under the auspices of the head of state.
Well, we're back again to Money Means Business, and we're talking a lot more about lots of things that are happening. What else is in the New Republic manifesting itself? As we see, with people coming, they see in all domains, and those who just are absent for, as you said, weekly and daily, and come back and just find something new happening.
I believe we are going in the right direction in all different sectors. In terms of agriculture, in terms of industry, yeah. In terms of education. And of course, when we talk about Egypt Vision 2030, they have a target. And in order to achieve this target, we have to all work hard. So you talked about management. Management is not just a word. Management, yeah. It simply means we have to work as a team. We have to really face all resistance to whatever change is happening in Egypt. And for people who come with a new idea, they meet with all different, through all social media, with resistance to change.
Definitely.
But the forces of change is greater than the forces of resistance to change. And I believe we are going to move forward as united. And of course, the Egyptian people, they are standing behind their leader. And of course, as I mentioned before, and I mentioned it several times, Egypt in the future, it will be in a different place. And remember, with all different forces against us, Egypt now, it has an identity. It has a significant position in the worldwide, and the rank of Egypt, it's moving upward year after year. I believe we have to stand behind our leadership. Okay. We have to work together, and that's simply management. Management, it means we have to be effective and efficient. We have to achieve all goals of Egypt Vision 2030.
Definitely. Well, you know, as I, you know, we are just at the end of Eid that finishes today, but still, you know, we are getting out of the holiday of Eid al-Adha al-Mubarak, or the greater Bayram, of course, wishing everybody they had and the blessings to remain throughout the year and years to come. Well, President Sisi met the people. Cairo was almost empty that day, you know, and they were all at the stadium. They were talking, and he was addressing the fears of the people, the, you know, the reactions and interactions, and the fears, or some, you know, who try to create fears of certain issues for no reason at all, and they try to push the public opinion and the people towards a certain thing that, you know, like, you know, certain targets, their own targets, you know, sick minds. However, you know, like one, you know, thing that President Sisi said, well, you shouldn't be really afraid of anything like that, because this is, you know, Egypt. Egypt is a great nation.
Absolutely.
Definitely. So this is a big change right now.
Absolutely. I believe in President Sisi. I believe in his judgment. I believe in his leadership. And I believe he knows what's in your mind and what's in my mind. And he will make the right decision at the right time.
Yes.
He knows what he's doing. And he said, don't worry. So I'm telling you, don't worry.
Definitely. And on this note, I just wish you the best for the Bayram and throughout the whole year and years to come.
Thank you very much.
Same thank you here. Very much, Dr. Sayed Khoury, for being with us. It's always thank a pleasure. You. I'd like to thank everybody for being there and wish them the great holidays and the blessings of the holidays to remain with them all year round, and to overwhelm the whole world, hopefully. So as we always end, God bless Egypt, God bless Egyptians, God bless our police, our army, our right army, our president. And as we quote from the Holy Quran, ادخلوا مصر إن شاء الله آمنين, enter Egypt, God willing, safe. And from the Holy Bible, مبارك شعبي مصر, blessed be Egypt, my people. I'm Nermin Nazim, signing off. We'll see you again next week. Goodbye for now.